Writers are tasked with bringing to society's attention instances of sexual violence that are often normalized or ignored in the mainstream. But sometimes as writers, you might end up unconsciously using some methods that, instead of addressing the problem, become a part of it. Listen carefully to the language the survivors use to describe themselves and their bodies and reflect that language back to them. Swap the word victim with the word survivor. When you attach the word victim to a person, you take away their agency and reduce them to helpless individuals instead of empowering them. Although a survivor does become a victim if they are murdered by the assaulter or if they die during the process of the assault, using such a word for them when they are alive can have consequences such as mental health issues, trauma, low self-esteem, and a lack of trust in the legal system. While writing, try writing in the active voice than in the passive voice. For example, she was attacked. When you write a statement like this, the focus of the identity shifts to the person as the abused rather than putting on the onus on the abuser. Try breaking away from that pattern and writing sentences like he attacked her. Similarly, a phrase like he forced his mouth on her is far more impactful and honest than he kissed her. When you write in passive voice, there is a suggestion that the abused had a role to play in the crime. In instances of sexual violence, we know this to be false.
Nothing in your reporting should indicate that the survivor was inviting trouble. It does not matter what time of the day it was, what clothes were being worn, or what her sexual history is. None of this matters. In cases of sexual violence, in most instances we see that in India, the perpetrator is mostly known to the survivor.
But the nature of the relationship should never matter. All that matters is that the act was non-consensual. While writing, avoid using phrases like she was frequently bringing men home, she was dressed skimpily, she was out drinking, or she was in a relationship with the abuser. None of that matters. When you use phrases like these, it leads to a kind of character assassination and victim blaming and shaming, which is what happens most of the times in these cases. While writing, remember not to reveal the survivor's names, address, or current whereabouts while highlighting their experiences. While some of the survivors may choose to do so, it is completely their choice and not yours. While writing, you have to realize that these are real people and have a right to privacy and safety. Following the December 2012 gang rape case, many people agreed that death penalty should be given for the rarest of rare cases of sexual violence. Avoid any kind of writing that endorses the idea that sexual violence crime have a worst to worst ranking, and remember that all crimes of sexual violence deserve the same kind of punishment and equal justice. As writers, you need to actively destabilize the binary that only women face violence by giving equal importance to narratives of survivors who are not cisgender women, such as transgender people, gay men, or male-identified persons. Is it any wonder that transphobic hate crimes and intimate partner violence in same-sex relationships were so underreported? While reporting, remember to keep an intersectional approach in your writing.
This leads us to the last point, that report on the violence men face, but get rid of the two. Saying sexual violence is targeted towards men is enough and end there. Saying, well, men have it just as bad, completely excludes patriarchal power dynamics and male privilege and suggests because men face it, we should be okay with other genders facing it too.
The next time you sit down to write, remember these points so that your reporting is sensitive and non-discriminatory.